Blog Talk Radio.
Welcome to the Networking Diva Hour radio show, always live, always heard worldwide.
Hello, listeners. Thank you for tuning in to the Networking Diva Hour today, and always a special thanks to the new listeners out there. Welcome. I'm your host, Janiece Carlson, for the next hour and every Friday morning here live on Blog Talk Radio. We are so happy each week to bring this program to you and give many tips on the do's and don'ts from networking, current events, to being the best that you can be, and all business information in between. We hope to guide you to success and to help put your best foot forward professionally, financially, and effectively. We look forward to your emails, your chats, your posts, your tweets. You can reach us in the chat room or send me an email at host@thenetworkingdivahour.com, and we will answer your questions to the best of our ability and help lead you to success. I say to you every week, if you're always networking, when are you working your business? So grab a latte and sit back and enjoy the show.
And I have another great quote in reference to today's show, which is all about how to achieve confidence and simple principles guiding you to easy success, with our special guest all the way from Australia, Damian Andrews, who will be on the show here shortly. But this wonderful other quote is from Albert Schweitzer. Success is not the key to happiness. Happiness is the key to success. If you love what you are doing, you will be successful. So thank you for that wonderful quote that we have in history. So today is Friday, the 21st of April already. And I hope you had a great week. We are so excited to bring this special show to you today. But I do want to make just a short announcement. We've had so many reviews and likes on last week's show about gun violence with Daniel Dulzinski. And he wrote the book, The First 5 Minutes, which you can get on Amazon. But I just wanted to make another notification today. This is the 111th day of 2023. And we've had over 170 mass shootings already in these 111 days. Over 3,000 people have been injured or killed or affected by gun violence so far this year. Excuse me. And that's all I'm going to say on that topic. But if you want to hear back last week's show, go into the network Blog Talk Radio, the Networking Diva Hour, and you can hear that show again and his tips on how we might be able to control some of this gun violence. Because, again, this week, it was horrible with all the wrong address, the wrong driveway, the wrong car. And yesterday topped it all, a six-year-old, her basketball rolled into her neighbor's yard, and her father went over there, and the gentleman that lived there decided to shoot them both. Luckily, the little girl just had a face graze, but the father is struggling in the hospital, so prayers to that family. And, of course, the culprit is nowhere to be found. So, people, what's happening? What's happening? Pick up the phone, not the gun, if something is bothering you on your property. So I want to start my show the way I always do, with thanking the people that have made it possible as we celebrate our 10th year. And that is Kathy Bilkus, your Tax Lady Accounting Services, Dr. Johnny Bergstrom with the Center of Gratitude Radio Show out of Jupiter, Florida, Shield 616, Protecting Our Protectors, the Colorado Springs Over 50.com business app, and Jack Seasoning, our latest sponsor, the only seasoning you will ever need. So definitely take a moment when we play our break for these wonderful sponsors that we have on our show. But that's all I have going on this week. Nothing else new that I know of. And like I said, we're going to have a great show today. And we're going to talk a little bit about some tips on how to find success in life. And then we'll have Damian on, like I said, in the middle of the night, all the way from Australia. He's going to sacrifice sleep to bring you some information on how to achieve confidence and simple principles. And we're just going to talk a little bit about what was sent to us from, I think, Entrepreneur Magazine. They didn't put it down for me. But some tips on how to find success in your life. You know, ladies and gentlemen, success is often defined as the ability to reach your goals in life. Whatever those goals may be, in some ways, a better word for success might be attainment, accomplishment, or progress. It is not necessarily a destination, but a journey that helps develop the skills and resources that you need to thrive. Because goals are self-centered, what people view as success can vary depending on their needs, their goals, and their situation. There are many different tactics on how to be successful in life, but the strategy that works best for you may depend on what success means to you. If you think of success as doing well at work or earning a high salary or losing a bunch of weight or your professional goals and accomplishments will take priority. While professional success can be one piece of the puzzle, it leaves out many other important areas of life. Family, romantic relationships, academics, and athletes are just a few areas where people may strive for success. Your definition of success may vary, but many might define it as being fulfilled, happy, safe, healthy, and loved. So what can you do to boost your chances of achieving these things? What are some of the habits of successful people? There is no single right way to be successful. What works for you might not work for someone else. There may not be a perfect combination of ingredients that can guarantee success. Still, there are some basic suggestions you can follow that can improve your chances of being successful in life, love, work, or whatever happens to be important to you. One of them is build a growth mindset. People with a growth mindset believe they have control of their life, while those with a fixed mindset believe that things are out of control. Improve your emotional intelligence. That's another one. Overall intelligence has long been believed to be one factor contributing to success in different areas of life, but some experts suggest that emotional intelligence may actually matter even more. Develop a mental toughness. This is a good one. Mental toughness refers to the resilience to carry on and continue trying even in the face of obstacles. People who possess this mental strength see challenges as opportunities. Excuse me. They also feel that they have control over their own destiny, are confident in their ability to succeed, and are committed to finishing what they started. Yeah, think about that. Another suggestion is to strengthen your willpower. Research has found that those who ultimately were the most successful in life shared some key characteristics, including perseverance and willpower. These characteristics tend to be part of an individual's overall personality, but they are also something you can improve. Delayed gratification, learning to persist in the face of challenges and waiting for the rewards of your hard work can often be the keys to success in life. Did you ever think of that? What's your key to success in life? I wonder, sometimes people all have different keys to success in life. And I always wonder what people's are. You know, everybody's different, self-motivation books. Who knows? Everybody has something different. The Myers-Briggs indicator, personal traits. But focus on intricate motivations. I want you to focus on that because it's really important, this one, I feel. And like I said, everybody has a personal one. But if you are doing things because you enjoy them, because you find them meaningful, or because you enjoy seeing the effects of your work, then you are driven by intricate motivations. Research has shown that while incentives can be a better predictor of some types of performance, intricate motivators tend to be better at predicting performance quality. While it is often the external motivations that get people started, it is the internal motivators that kick in and keep people going in order to maintain those new behavior. Let's face it, most advice about success is not always bad. Sometimes it's really good. Set achievable goals. Successful people know that they need to start by having obtainable goals to achieve. These goals are not necessarily easy to reach, but by having something to aim for, you will be better able to move forward and overcome obstacles. Nurture traits linked to high potential. According to some most recent research, there are certain traits that tend to be consistently tied to success. Key traits can play a role in how well people do at work. However, they note that there are optimal levels of these traits. Too little of these characteristics can hinder success, but so can having too much. Cultivate strong social support. Doing things alone can be very difficult, but having a strong social support system can make these things so much easier. Different types of social support can be important for success. Mentors, friends, coworkers, and family members can cheer you on when things get tough and even offer advice and assistance that can help you improve your chances for success. But the main thing, ladies and gentlemen, is to avoid burnout. Burnout can happen when you are exposed to chronic stress. It can seriously impede success and lend to exhaustion, cynicism, and reduced performance. Sometimes this might mean reassessing your goals. If your goals are creating too much stress, or if you're trying to achieve too much too fast, it can be a recipe for burnout. Look for ways to reduce stress, whether that involves shifting your goals, changing your plan, or even doing something more significant, like moving somewhere else, or even changing jobs. Whoa, that was a heavy one. But after all, if most of it was good advice instead of bad advice, you and I would have to assume, given the sheer volume of advice on the topic a person can assess at the click of a button, there would be a lot more successful people in the world today. But as we both know, that really is not the case. Unfortunately, despite the good intentions, most of our success suffers from one fatal flaw. It's built around a short-sighted definition of what success really is. Society is quick to tell you that success means having a nice car, a big house, a boat, a large travel budget. You know, we cling to things like this as indicators of success because they're so easily visible. Over time, we develop tunnel vision about them, blinding ourselves to the possibility of pursuing things that actually make a lasting difference, like your legacy, your level of influence, spending time with your family, your ability to give to those in need. I really like that. So when searching for keys to success, it's important to take advice with a grain of salt. Be aware of the most of its design to help you obtain more things rather than making more of an impact. As I suspect, success means more to you than maybe the kind of car in your driveway. So, you know, I encourage you, if that's what your success is, then that's great. But if it's the other things, your legacy, like I said, spending time with your family, whatever you feel is success, and Damian will let you know how to be more confident and the ability to gain success in however you think success is to you. Determine what success looks like for you. Give your actionable steps to achieving it. Each of these steps during your time studying your people around you or history's great achievers, no matter their area of expertise, they all have similar habits and beliefs that help them produce incredible results. So that's just a little bit about, you know, success. And instead of simply saying, what does success look like for me, I want you to make a slight change in that question. Ask yourself, what would a successful life look like for me? So there you go. Just a little bit of information. And we're going to take a short break and come back with Damian Andrews, all the way from Australia in the middle of the night. So we appreciate him being here, but take a moment to listen to our sponsors that have made this show possible as we celebrate our 10th year. I'm your host, Janiece Carlson, and I will be right back.
Do you often find yourself struggling to find the joy in every day? Would you like to feel as good as you know you should? The daily struggle to find joy and happiness is shared by hundreds of millions of people around the world, and you don't have to be among them any longer. Hi, I'm the gratitude doctor, Johnny Bergstrom. For years, I struggled to find the joy that I knew I should feel, and after years of heartache and unhappiness, I treated my life with gratitude, and gratitude changed everything. I can coach you to heal your life with gratitude. Find the Center of Gratitude radio show and the Gratitude Doctor podcast, and in 15 minutes or less, you'll be well on your way to that joyful feeling with gratitude.
Accounting can be one of the most time-consuming aspects of operating a small business, but it is paramount to the success of your business, especially since 2021. The work can be extremely overwhelming for business owners who lack the time, knowledge, and skills to properly handle their accounts. Your Tax Lady LLC Accounting Service utilizes their knowledge and experience to professionally handle your small business accounting needs. They are also equipped to remotely handle most small business needs nationwide and welcome you to contact them for a consultation. Your Tax Lady, Kathy Bilkis, is an enrolled agent and America's tax expert working for you for over 40 plus years. Call Your Tax Lady today at 719-548-4924 or online at taxladyllc.com. Your tax lady continues to check your bottom line, so the government still doesn't get it all.
Colorado Springs Over50.com is a newly designed online member directory for businesses and organizations that provide products and services for the over 50 population. The directory features your own marketing landing page, electronic business card, event postings, member page, activity analysis, and more. So text the word CS Over 50, that is CSOVER 50, to 72727. And visit our website to see other features and benefits. Stop by online today at ColoradoSpringsOver50.com or text to receive our electronic business card. Colorado Springs Over 50, the best is yet to come.
Jack seasoning is a classic Midwest flavor used for all things bland that needs just a little shake to bring out the goodness. Their unique flavor is subtle, not hot or exotic. From meats, vegetables, and eggs to Bloody Marys, this three-generation-old blend gives the satisfying feeling of home. Jack seasoning will make you a grill master, too. Shake once for flavor, twice for extreme, and three times for crazy. Visit our website at Jack, that's J-A-K, seasoning.com, to order and see recipes. Jack Seasoning turns a cook into a chef with one shake.
Now back to the Networking Diva Hour with your host, Janiece Carlson.
Welcome back, listeners. Thank you for taking a short moment to hear from the sponsors that we currently have and that we thank for helping us celebrate our 10th year on air. I want to talk a little bit about my guest today. Damian Andrews is a CEO, international speaker, philanthropist, and father, and he demystifies the simple and easy life and business steps to help grow your revenue and profit. He speaks to audiences around the globe, bringing fresh life to often overlooked fundamental principles essential for rapid success. Drawing from skills learned as a CEO, business founder, operational efficiency professional, commercial and contracts expert, corporate recovery specialist, and in Australia's Special Air Service Regiment, known as SASR, Damian runs a private equity firm and consistently achieves double-digit returns, cash in the bank. His life wasn't always like that. It used to be really, really hard. He learned life has simple principles guiding you to easy success, money, success, peace, happiness, and love. It's all within an easy grasp. Damian says, "Let me help you slide elephants through eyes of needles." Ladies and gentlemen, all the way from Australia in the middle of the night, please help me welcome Damian Andrews. Good evening.
Good morning, Janiece. How are you? It is morning here too. You're 10 a.m. or 10:30 a.m. I'm 2:30 a.m., but in a different day.
Yeah, it's just after 10 a.m. It's about 10:20 a.m. here in Colorado. But we really appreciate you coming up in the middle of the night to give this wonderful presentation to my audience who are listening with bated breath. And I hope I did you justice by speaking about your bio a little bit. But Damian, the part that got me is when you said it wasn't always like that, it used to be really hard, your life. Why don't you give a little tip about that before you start giving our audience information on how to achieve confidence and simple principles?
Thank you for that, and I'm honored to be on the show, and great question too. And yet my life was difficult. I had times where, you know, I was nearly went broke a couple of times, didn't have much money, found it difficult to get jobs, difficult to have relationships, and it was really a bit of a challenge. And then I learnt that, you know, life isn't harder, we make it hard. We're creatures of habits and beliefs, and those beliefs and habits shape what we see. Our reticular activating system filters out information that's right there in front of us. It's the old Acres of Diamonds story. There's an amazing opportunity right in front of us, and a lot of times we miss it because of how our beliefs are set and the habits that we follow each day. But when I learned that was the case and the problem wasn't the world, the problem was me, then I could change that and make my way forward.
Hmm. Very interesting. But you came out on the good side. Apparently, it took long work and hard work, and here you are today living a successful life. So I want you to talk a little bit about the ways that people, because so many people today, I really feel, especially after COVID, you know, they're insecure, they're not sure of how to achieve anything now that they're back to work or trying to rebuild. But I want you to give them some simple principles guiding them to easy success. And I'll only interrupt you when we have a few questions coming in from our live audience.
No problem. Thank you for that. A lot of times from that perspective, and this is from a confidence side of things, we get confused as to what confidence is. And confidence is not something that we get. You can't go to a supermarket and buy confidence. It's not on the shelf. It doesn't exist there. Because confidence, it's not something that you have. Confidence is something that you do, and it comes from inside. And people misconstrue confidence with experience. A lot of times to go, you know, I'm not a good speaker because, you know, I've never done that before. Or, you know, I'm not a good speller is a good example. I was never a good speller, still not a good speller. But that doesn't mean I don't try and give it a go. And the thing that we forget is as a child, before we could walk, they did studies on this. It's quite amazing that little babies, when you were a little baby, when you tried to walk, you got up and fell down around 8,000 times. It's quite astounding when you think about that. There's 8,000 times you stood up and fell over before you actually were able to walk confidently, is what we perceive confidently. But I would say you were able to walk with some expertise. And that's where it's different from what confidence is, that each time you fell over as a child, you got up and did it again. Then you fell over and got up and you did it again. And then soon after that, you had expertise. And that's the difference between confidence and expertise. A lot of people misconstrue those. So what we need to do is remember that confidence is not the having an ability to do something well. That's expertise. What confidence is saying to yourself, I'm going to try it again. I've fallen over. I'm going to try it again. I gave that public speech. I fumbled words. I'm going to try it again. And you get up and do it again. Or I'm going to, you know, apply for a job, and you apply for a job and you don't get the job, or you don't present yourself very well. It's not experience. It's confidence. They will look at it and saying, yeah, I didn't, you know, do that very well. What can I do better? And I'll give it another go. And that's what confidence is. But the other component of that that we forget, or we may not even know, is the part that self-esteem plays in that. And that's very different from confidence as well. Self-esteem is how much you like yourself just for who you are. So it doesn't matter, you know, whether you are a hugely successful, quote-unquote, as, you know, you might have, you know, you might not have millions in the bank, but it doesn't matter. It's a case of whether you actually like yourself just for who you are. So when you wake up in the morning, you go, yeah, I'm a good person. And an experience that I have there where it's really important to know the difference is the difference between your behaviors and the difference between who you are. Who you are is a wonderful person. You're a miracle that's been put on this earth. for however you believe that came about. But you are this unique being. There's no one else like you. Even identical twins are slightly different. So you're very unique. And that's special, extremely special. The different being is that your behaviors are not who you are. Many years ago, I was helping a friend with a wedding, and there was a space at the front of the church for the bridal car to pull up. It wasn't marked. And someone parked there who were coming to the wedding. So obviously they were coming to the wedding and went, oh, great, this parking spot right up front. How fantastic is that? So I've seen, oh, no, this person's parked in where the bridal car is. So I've stormed over and now I've gone, what are you parking there for? And I've yelled at the guy. And he had his partner with him. And it's, what are you parking there? Where's the bride going to park? And I've yelled at him. Not an appropriate way to behave. But I was looking after the bride. And he moved on. But now when I look back at that, I could be beating myself up and saying, how terrible a person might be behaving that way. And, yeah, it wasn't the best way to behave. My intention was good. I just didn't behave that way. Now, if that's behave in the right way. Now, if that situation came up again today, I would behave very, very differently. And that's the what we want to separate and what we need to separate to feel good about ourselves is that we are good people. Sometimes our behaviors could do with a bit of work. And that's where it makes it easier on yourself, because when you look at it that way, your body starts producing dopamine when you think good things about yourself. You don't have to do things. I mean, there's a lot out there about when you do something, your body feels good. Yeah, your body produces dopamine and serotonin. But you don't even have to do it. You just have to think it. And that's where that comes in, is when you separate your person from your behaviors, you can say, okay, in that situation, I did the best I could. Probably maybe it wasn't the best way to behave now with hindsight, because we can all look back with hindsight and 2020 and go, oh, we should have done this differently. And if you do that, that's wonderful that you've looked back and gone, hey, I could do this better. So you should congratulate yourself for that. And by doing that, you'll actually feel good. Not only that, you'll be more receptive to learning. We learn better when we feel good about ourselves. And so when you look back and go, oh, okay, I'm a good person, but that behavior probably wasn't that great. I could do that slightly different. How could I do that differently? And all of a sudden you come up with different ideas. It's a good question. Your body, your mind always looks at answers to questions you ask of it. Not why am I an idiot, but how can I do this differently? How can I get a better result than what I got? And all of a sudden you'll find this answer and you'll feel good, because your body will naturally produce dopamine. You'll immediately feel more confident. So that's how they all link together. Experience is the ability to, you've done it over and over again, so you have enough. It's like being, you mentioned I was in the military. It's similar in America with the military. They run drills to give you that experience. So when something happens, you react more competently. And then, but the difference is to get to that point of view, to get to that is that, practicing, it's getting back up, like you did when you were trying to walk. You fell over, you got back up. And it was that willingness to get back up, which is confidence. So that's where we need to look at and separate that two, experience from confidence. And the third part of that is self-esteem. And that is liking yourself. When you like yourself, it doesn't matter what happens. It doesn't matter if, I look at it and there's a number of times here where today where, things don't go very well as far as experience goes. I do something, it didn't go, I go to a board meeting and I don't get the point across that I want to get across, and I've got to wait a month to the next board meeting to get the next, to try and push that forward. I still like myself. I don't go, oh, I'm a terrible person because I didn't get that across. I gave it the best shot. I like myself. Next time I'm going to give it another go. And that's where the self-esteem part comes in, that no matter what happens, that you like yourself, because you are this wonderful ball of light that contributes beautiful things to the world in some way or another. And that's where we, when I talk, sorry, did you have a question there? Or?
We have a question on confidence that was coming in. It's from Lily Ann H. from Monterey, California, and she's asking you, can having a healthy level of self-confidence help you become more successful in your personal and professional life? And can it help your level of confidence affect how you present yourself to others?
100%, definitely. And that's where, again, it's your choice. When I used to go for a job, I would always wear a suit and tie because it made me feel more confident. That was a choice that I made. And how you feel about yourself is going to affect how you present yourself. So definitely, it makes a big, big difference to have that confidence. But again, it's a choice. It's if you hunch your shoulders over, look at the floor and then feel how empowered you are. It's not great. Stand up straight, put your shoulders back, look at the top corner of the ceiling, and feel a difference in your body. It's immediately different. And that's how we can actually trick ourselves into feeling a little bit more confident, by recognizing how our physiology affects how we think as well, so that we can trick it. We don't have to do that, but it's if you train your brain to just automatically think confidently, that, hey, no matter what happens, I'm going to give it a go, then you don't have to do that. But if you do find yourself getting stuck, an easy way to do that is just stand straight, look at the top corner of the building where the wall joins the ceiling, and you'll immediately feel much more confident.
Good answer. Thank you, Lily, for that question. Well, keep going. I'm really thrilled with what you're saying today. And I loved your story.
That's right. Yeah, well, that's where it leads into the next part when we talk about life being easy. And that was something that I struggled with a lot, because I found a lot of challenges, things are difficult. People talk about this all the time, life is hard. And what I've learned is life is actually quite, it's built up of very simple principles. And if you follow those principles, life becomes very easy. The thing is, we make it more complicated than we need to. An example of a principle or rule in life is, if you went up to into a high rise in a building, to say to the 22nd floor, went out onto the balcony, and you jumped off, no matter how much you might believe gravity doesn't exist, you're going to go down. Or even if you're not even aware gravity exists, you're going to go down. And this is, when you look at it from that perspective, oh, that's pretty extreme, but life is like that. If you want to have a healthy, happy relationship, the first thing to do is to be healthy and happy in the relationship with you. It's to, like yourself, know who you are, know what it is that's important for you in your life. And then when you know that, you define, okay, what do I want in a partner? How is that going to, what sort of partner would complement me? And then from there, you can go and find that person. Most people don't go through. They have some wonderful friends in Canada. They have they wrote a book, The Unbreakable Marriage, and they talk about this very principle. They say you don't have marriage problems. You're two people with problems that you're bringing to the marriage, which is a different way of looking at it. Because a lot of times in a relationship, the two of you going, hey, what's wrong with you? Why aren't you doing this? Rather than looking at ourselves and going, what do I want? Who am I and what do I want? And so that's a simple principle. It's not a hard question, is it? Who am I? We just choose that. It's not a question where it's this esoteric. You can go through this process, but really it's just a choice. I'm X. I have a personal mission statement that I wrote that helps me define who I am. And that mission statement is that I enjoy life and share in the joys of others. I learn something daily that helps me overachieve, and I confidently and compassionately act from my values of honesty, excellence, and understanding. And from that, that guides what I do every day. Now, was I born with that? I don't know. Maybe I was, maybe I wasn't. I just wrote it out one day and said, that's who I am. And I made that decision. And then from there, that has then shaped the people that I associate with. Because if I meet someone and I get an inkling that they're not an honest person, I go, well, maybe they're not the person I want to associate with. Similar with money, people, money is a big issue for many people. When you look at that with money, if you want to, there's four principles to have wealth. The first one is you've got to earn money. And how you earn money is you add value. It's as simple as that. So when you either have a job, you add value. And what a lot of people don't realize is there's research that shows that someone that works, say, an extra hour a week will earn, on average, 40% more than someone that doesn't. Now, an hour, extra hour a week in a day is not 40% more work time. It doesn't correlate that way. But I don't know if you've heard the story of the two people walking through the jungle and a tiger jumps out. And one person starts putting on their running shoes. And the other person says, what are you putting on your running shoes? You can't outrun a tiger. And the first person says, I don't have to outrun the tiger. I've just got to outrun you. And in this world, that's what it is. And when we talk about adding value to an income, it's not that hard to be that little bit better than the people around you, because there's a lot of people out there not putting in a great deal of effort. Now, the other thing is that is, you know, we've all heard the statement, work smarter, not harder. But when you look at it, and be honest with yourself, when you look at yourself, do we actually work smarter, or are we repeating the same habits over and over again, which is what I started with? We're creatures of beliefs and habits. We repeat the same habits over and over again and then get upset because we're not getting different results. And as Einstein said, doing the same thing and expecting a different result is the definition of insanity. And so that's from that perspective of earning money. It's putting in a little bit of extra effort. Now, effort is different. You can actually do the same. You can do a little bit of extra effort without actually being at the office an hour longer. You can actually restructure things, work a little bit smarter, do some work a little bit differently so that you produce extra results, which is going to result in that income. So that first principle to earn money is just to add some extra value. And there's ways of doing that. And we have a number of programs at damianandrews.com that shows you how to do that quite easily and effectively. We have a program on how to start your new job with a higher salary and also how to negotiate higher salaries. And part of that is linked to demonstrating the value that you are providing to the employer. The other way you can do it if you're not employees is through a business, is starting a business. Both ways, whether it's employee or starting a business, you're adding value to other people's lives. And when you recognize that you're getting paid for adding value, you can then shift your thinking as to looking for ways, how can I add value in the most efficient way? So that's principle one for earning money. The other, to have wealth, there's three principles, and I didn't come up with this. They are, if you want to take one of the oldest books, it's in the Bible about how to have this. It was also in a book by George S. Carlson, written nearly 100 years ago, called The Richest Man in Babylon. And those three principles are, it's save a little bit of what you earn, invest that little bit that you save, and then reinvest the income you get from that. Again, those four principles, they're not difficult. They're very simple. Add value, save a little bit of what you earn, invest that bit you save and reinvest. Simple principles. And when we recognize that and go, hang on a minute, it's me not following those principles that's causing the problem, then all of a sudden your life can change.
Let's take another quick question. And it's from Wes P. from Jupiter, Florida. And he's asking or stating, I know success is often defined as the ability to reach our goals in life, whatever those goals may be. In some ways, a better word for success might be attainment, accomplishment, or progress. It is not necessarily a destination, but the journey that helps develop the skills and resources we need to thrive. Do you agree?
Yeah, great question. Goal attainment—it's an interesting process to achieving goals. And I mean, what I think the question is leading to is happiness, how to be happy and fulfilled with your life, and that comes down to the rules we've set up for our life. I have a program. If you go to my, it's a free downloadable on my website, DamianAndrews.com. It's the 4 steps to attract your goals, how to make your goals come to you. Your future is defined on what you choose. And what we look at there is, you know, how your brain works. Within your brain, linked to your beliefs, is what's called your reticular, well, it's actually a physical part of your brain called the reticular activating system. And that filters what we see. And I mean, I guess for the audience, I think you can all relate to this, is if you think about it, have you ever had a bad day? And on the flip side, have you ever had a good day? And the question is, what was the difference between, because on a bad day, no matter what happens, it always turns out really crappy. But on a good day, similar sort of thing, no matter what happens, it turns out great. So what is the difference between those 2 days? And this is where working towards any goals that you might set, and people talk about goals and intentions. Sometimes we have intentions. It's not an endpoint. It's actually an ongoing thing. Like, I'm going to live my life with purpose is an intention. And so that's where from that intention side of things links to, I think, what the listener was asking about, how do you feel great every day? Because my day, I wake up every day, I feel awesome about my day, and it hasn't started yet, but I feel awesome that I woke up and that I've got a day ahead of me. And at the end of the day, I go to bed feeling great. And during the day, when things happen out of the blue, you go, oh my God, I wish that didn't happen. But I don't have that. Something happened, and it's like, how can I use that to get where I'm going? I draw from Shakespeare in Hamlet, scene two, act two. Hamlet wrote, nothing is good or bad. Thinking makes it so. And that's where we have a slightly different philosophy on that, is that events are not positive or negative. Because, again, that becomes inefficient. If you think, oh, I've got to find the good in this, that's an extra step you have to take. Whereas if you say, it's an event, how do I use that to get where I want to go? Immediately, you don't have to find the good in it. It's immediately something that's going to serve you, which makes life a lot easier. And so from that perspective, when you go through your day, as you're working towards the journey, as the listener called in about, the journey is always enjoyable. The journey is always pleasurable because there's always the capacity for growth in it. There's always the ability to learn something. And then when we talk about the achievement of goals, on the program that I mentioned, the downloadable, the 4 steps to attract your goals, is what we do is we set a very clear things that we want to achieve. And Warren Buffett talked about this. If you know, for those that know Warren Buffett, or not, maybe don't know him personally, but know of Warren Buffett, he said, make a big list of what you want to achieve. And then everything below the 5th item, cross off the list. And that's your list for your life. So it's 5 things you're planning to achieve for your life. Steve Jobs were very similar. He was a rule of threes. You only have 3 current goals in your life. What we do is we have a program where in the downloadable, we set goals in 3 areas. And the same principle applies whether it's personal or business. But in your personal life, you'd set economic goals, personal goals, and toys and thing goals. And from that, you make a list. The program that we teach is that you make a list in those 3 categories. I want X amount of income, or I want, a certain amount of net worth, or the personal goals, or the things you want to learn and how you're going to give, the types of relationships you want, and the toys and thing goals are the fun stuff. We've got to have the fun stuff. I have lots of Lego. I love my Lego, and, I like collecting it and building, and it's my little space where I just a bit of fun. And you set those goals in those areas, and then you might make a big list, and you keep your big list, that's fine, but you choose the 2 most important ones in each of those categories, and that becomes your focus. That's what you do. And when you achieve them, then you go back to your list, or you add to your list, and you choose another goal. And in business, the same principle applies, but we focus in different areas. again, economic goals, how much revenue and profit you want the business to earn, what the assets it will own, those kind of things. But then there's operational goals. And these relate to how the business operates, how it generates leads, the sales process, the customer care, the quality assurance, the cost reduction systems. But again, you go through that and you have a priority where you achieve the goal before you move on to the next one, because otherwise you're trying to do, can be trying to do thousands of things all at once and you don't accomplish everything. And the third area in it for a business where you set the goals is cultural. And this is the feel associated with the business that it, you know, from its employees to its customers. So this is the feel that you want. And you'll notice, I mean, I think we've all seen movies about, I think it's Google or those kind of tech companies where they have this fun feel. And Apple back in the day had this feel that it was a rebel company. It was breaking new boundaries. There's one with, I think it's Zappos in America, which they have a feel where the person is always listened to. I think it was where, if I remember, and correct me, I'm sure this will correct me if I've got this wrong, but it was a company in America where they never hang up. If it's from a customer care, it has to be the customer that hangs up. And there was a phone call that went for 12 hours or something with a customer care officer. It could be an urban legend.
But yeah, I never heard of that myself. So.
Yeah, it was a philosophy within the organization that they make the customer feel welcomed by never hanging up. It's the customer that hangs up on the customer call. And there was a phone call that went through it, and it was long. I've got it written down somewhere. I have got it in front of me. But that's where, again, from that perspective of goals, is that we want to set the goals in those areas. Whether it's an individual, economic, personal, toys and things, and business, again, economic, operational, and cultural. And then from that, if we focus on those goals, and the reason we do that in those specific areas is because part of it is the journey. We feel good about accomplishing that. But when you actually do finish accomplishing it, you get a great sense of satisfaction. And I have a program called Max Time where we teach this for individuals as to how to get the most out of your day. And we set up the day so that when you tick off your boxes, each time you tick off a box, you're going, oh, I feel awesome. And, oh, you do another, tick off another one. Oh, that feels great. Because you've actually accomplished it. So part of it is the journey. We certainly enjoy the journey, but the other part is the accomplishment. We want to set our day up so that when we look at it at the end of the day before we go to bed, this is what I do. I go to bed and go, I did this, I did this, I did this, I did this. How cool is that? And I go to sleep feeling really, really wonderful and have these crazy dreams of all these great things that I'm doing. I hope that answers the listener's question.
Yeah, that's a very good answer. Let's take one last question, and then I want to talk to you a little bit about how people can engage with you. But this is from, well, I lost it now. Oh, Joel K. from Denver, Colorado, and he stated, I personally feel the main thing is that you always have to be physically fit to show your commitment and determination to achieve your success. If we fail, we can't fulfill our eagerness of achieving success. Successful life means breathing and moving naturally. We just can't ignore it. So we need to be fit and look after our bodies daily. So do you agree?
That's a great question. More so, I think it's a statement rather than a question.
Yeah.
But yeah,
right.
Certainly, I have a foundation called share.care, which is S-H-A-I-R. Care, and it's an acronym for strong, healthy, and inspiring relationships, and that's where you can find me a lot. It has its own podcast, and we have some wonderful people, and they're actually exploring what is manly at the moment as well. It's one of the subsets within the podcast. But the share.care is based on 10 principles, and it starts with, and the first one, although they're not really ordered, but the first one is personal responsibility. You have the responsibility to choose your own actions. And the second is find your source of strength, whatever that is. But yes, from that perspective, part of that is also having the ability, we've got in there health, look after your body, allow your body the best chance to function at its highest capacity. And from that perspective, if we are going to do things in life, the vessel that we move around in is our body. And the more ability, the healthier our body is, the more ability it has to operate effectively. If you take, you know, for an example, you might have an old beat up car that when you go to start it, it doesn't start and you've got to kick the tires a few times to get it to go, that kind of thing. If your body's in that state, it becomes very difficult to accomplish things and achieve them because you haven't looked after your health. So yet from your listener's perspective, it's a very, very good principle to take care of your body because it's what you move around this world in. If you believe you're a spiritual being that's within a body, if that body is not in good shape, good form, then it's going to be it's a lot more difficult to accomplish things in this world. So, yeah, I would agree with your listener in that regard. Take care of your body.
Very, very good. A very good answer. I really appreciate that. But we only have a few minutes left, and I want my audience to know if they want to continue to hear what you have to say or get in touch with you, what is the best way?
If you want to find me, just Google my name, Damian Andrews, D-A-M-I-A-N. But if you put E-N, you'll still find me. I'm every link on the front page of Google. I'm probably up after the front page, but who goes beyond the first page of Google? But you can, I'm also, my website is damianandrews.com. That's my personal website. But also, too, you'll find me a lot if you want to listen to what I've got to say, is the shared.care podcast, which is on all podcast platforms. But you can also find it at shared.care, which is shair.care. Just plug that into any web browser and you'll find the details. And we've got the 10 principles we talked about. The other thing we have is called the code. And what we wanted was a detailed or a higher set of principles that we hold ourselves to. And we're looking at where do we get that from? What we did is we went back to the medieval knight's code, the knight's code of chivalry. And we rewrote that from modern era and we made it gender neutral. And we talk about things like, you know, when you, one of the codes is to like yourself and separate your behaviors from the person. Another one is to laugh at yourself and not take offense at the opinions of others. And when you operate by the code, it's amazing how different your life is. But, yeah, certainly you can find me at damianandrews.com. I'm on LinkedIn if you search through LinkedIn. But at share.care is my foundation where we do a lot of work that helps a lot of people. And the share.care podcast, there's lots of long-form interviews with some really, really amazing people, some really awesome people that share wonderful information. And we have a number of subsets in there. We have What is Manly, where we're looking for the framework for what makes up a man. We have eShare, which is about equal, strong, healthy, and inspiring relationships. And we talk about how it's detrimental to men to oppress women. You actually want to lift women up, men.
Well, everything
so it
sounds
makes
wonderful,
like
but we have to end our show, and I want to take a moment to thank you for staying up in the middle of the night to bring my live audience this great information. They'll have your information now to continue, but I personally want to say thank you for all this great information, and it is an honor to have you on our show. So you have a wonderful night, and hopefully we'll be talking to you again. Thank you, Damian.
It's a pleasure, Janiece. Have a wonderful day.
Bye-bye. That was Damian Andrews. You can go to damianandrews.com for more information and listen back to this wonderful show today right after we shut down. It'll go into Blog Talk Radio, the networkingdivahour.com on the link. And you can listen to it and share it with a friend because he gave some great information out to achieving confidence and some simple principles guiding you to easy success. So I thank him for sacrificing some sleep to give us this information. So next week we'll have Tracy Serrano. She's going to talk about, or Serino, maybe that's how she says her name, professional speaker helping successful entrepreneurs reach their highest potential. So please tune in next week. But until then, have a blessed week, a safe week. And remember, pick up the phone, not the gun. if you're having problems with people on your property. That was my quote for this week. But until next week, I will see you on the radio. Blessings. I got the eye of the tiger.